Victoria and Waterloo.
When did you graduate there?
Where did I graduate? I graduated Waterloo.
When?
96.
96, okay.
That's why I can't hear you very well, because I graduated so long ago. Things are starting to fall apart.
I'm not far behind you. I'm 99, so not far behind.
Okay, so yeah, you'll get there.
Yeah, no, I feel it someday, that's for sure.
Hello, Irene. No, now she's gone again.
So thanks, you guys, for arriving. We're going to get started in just a minute. We're just waiting for our third panelist, having some techie issues. But if she's not here in a minute, we'll get started without her, and we'll loop her in when she gets here. So we've got lots of people showing up. I see Ann Chong. I see Howard Dolman, Janet Vanderpost, Don Garland, Carla Reimer, Nancy Gordon. I see Sean Larson, lots of people. Hi, there's Irene. Hi, Irene, can you?
Hear me now?
I can hear you. Great, welcome.
Oh. Hi, sorry.
Well, listen, we're gonna get going because we've got an action-packed hour. We've got lots of people arriving. I'm just going to start and get everybody going. Okay, so welcome. Happy Friday, everyone. We are going to record this. So if for any reason you are late, you got to leave early, it'll be available on Facebook after. I want to get started by introducing our panel. Before we do that, I am Trudi Charest from Marketing for ECPs. I'm the co-founder of Marketing for ECPs. We're a digital agency that helps eye care professionals with everything from websites to social media, you name it, we do it. And today is a really interesting panel discussion. If you were following us in the spring, we did a lot of panels with optometrists and opticians. Really talking about the shutdown and, you know, how they were dealing with the pandemic. The very last webinar we did with three optometrists at the end of May was called Never Look Back, and it was as practices were about to reopen. So now we brought a new panel in, and our talk today is called Only Look Forward. And this is really going to be, you know, chatting about what is it like running a practice during a pandemic. You know, what are some of the challenges and what are some of the success and best practices we can share to really, you know, help practices continue to deal with this, because we really don't know how long this is going to continue to happen, right? Just so you know, we do have a chat box, so please feel free to ask questions. I'll be watching for them, and what I'll do is, if we can, I'll incorporate them during the panel discussion, and if not, we'll leave some room at the end to answer any of your questions. So, you know, feel free to shout out to these guys and ask them anything. You know, these three are all from different geographies in Canada. I'm going to let them introduce themselves and talk a little bit about, you know, where they're from. Tell these guys a little bit about your practice, a little bit about you. So I am going to start. So Dr. Robert Alloway is in my top right corner, so I'm going to start with him.
Thanks, Trudi. Robert Alloway, I practice in British Columbia. We have, there's four partners and a couple of associates. We have three locations, a main location in Salmon Arm and two smaller locations a little bit to the west of us.
Great. Thank you. I'm going to move down to Dr. Irene Mestito-Dow.
Hi, I'm from Winnipeg. So I practice at Henderson Vision Center in Winnipeg. It's a practice that's been around over 40 years. We have six doctors, but we do three doctors a day is what we work. I just practice in the one place and I volunteer at the CNIB and on a probably every other week I'm volunteering at CNIB doing low vision clinic there. We have 15 staff, and if that might be interesting to know, I mean, we in Winnipeg, the numbers were pretty good. We closed on March 20. We were open again May 4th. So we've been open for a bit.
Great. Thank you. And then I'm going to move over to Dr. Robert. So yes, we do have two Roberts. This might get a little confusing. We have Dr. Robert McAlpine. Did I say that right?
Close, yes. It's Robert McAlpine. That's all right. born and raised in Southern Ontario. Did my optometry in Boston. I lived in practice there for 12 years before I moved my family back to Canada, 2011, and worked as an associate for a couple of years before I bought a practice in Aurora, Ontario. That's just for those of you not from Ontario, it's due north of Toronto, part of the GTA, practice, solo practice here in Aurora. I've been here 7 years now.
Great. Thank you. Yeah. So we have, you know, BC covered, Manitoba covered, Ontario covered, and I'm sure we're going to get some really great insights from these guys talking about, you know, how their practices have been affected since the reopening, since the closures. So I'm actually going to go to each one of you for this next question and really start. Let's talk about the reopening of your practices, you know, whether that was in June or when it was. Maybe talk about what was a challenge, what was maybe one of the biggest challenges, what is still a challenge? You know, what are you, I guess, doing to kind of get through right now? And we're going to get into some of the, you know, other tips and strategies too. But for now, let's just talk a little bit about some of the challenges. So I'm gonna actually go backwards. So I'm gonna go to Robert M. to start us off.
So for us, I'm sure like most people, you know, the biggest challenge was how do we keep our patients and our staff safe? How do we create a safe environment? At least for us, that meant cutting back the schedule, changing the way we schedule and changing the way we schedule, not just routine appointments, but follow-ups and urgent care, et cetera, and still maintain revenue. That to me was really the crux of it. So, you know, it was all about trying to plan, what are we going to do differently? You know, obviously initially it was, how do we safely reopen? What does that mean? How do we have people flow through the office? How are we scheduling to accommodate? You know, do we need to start scheduling things like, spectacle pickups? How do we push some of those off? What are we going to do in each of our exam lanes, et cetera, et cetera? I'm sure I'm saying a lot of things a lot of people already thought about. But to me, the biggest challenge of all is we're going to cut back majorly, and yet, you know, we still want to try to achieve revenue that we've been accustomed to. So to me, that was really the biggest initial challenge, no question about it.
And what about, what would you say now that you've been open for a couple months and, you know, you're into almost the end of September, what would you say is the biggest challenge still to date?
That's a good question. I mean, fortunately, it's been fairly successful. So I would say probably the biggest thing is just keeping the supply of PPE coming in without having to
talk about PPE.
You know, research on a regular basis. That's been tough. I think, obviously we're going to talk about all these things a little bit more, but I think, a lot of planning in place has kept it so that the wheels been rolling on pretty well, actually.
Okay, great. Perfect. Irene, tell us a little bit about your experience.
I think the first, for us, because it seemed to be happening around us, more so, and like I said, it hit Winnipeg a little bit later. The biggest thing, right, especially in March, was even just making the decision of what to do. Like, as things were coming down the pipeline, how are we going to change to go with it? Are we going to stay open? We were actually in conversation with a bunch of different practices, and we're all sort of, everyone is texting back and forth and going like, well, what are you doing? I don't know. What are you doing? And honestly, making that first decision to close, because we decided to close just a few days before it was actually recommended to close. But there was that week of stress where we were literally, like I have my, like I said, I have two other partners, and we were talking sometimes at 11 at night, you know, as things were changing and going, well, we just heard this, does this change our decision? Like, what are we going to do with the staff? And through March and April was with all the changes in the pay, we're going to put you on EI. We're not going to put you on EI. We can put you on CERB. And, you know, all of those calculations, that was probably my biggest headache up until August. That was one of the biggest things because the staffing and every time someone came back with, you know, I might have contact, what do we do? And trying to decide the protocol of how we're going to keep the practice afloat and keep everybody sane and try to keep everyone as employed as we could with, like Robert said, without bleeding money. Because, you know, for 6 weeks, all we could see was emergencies. And, you know, what we were going to do with that. So, I mean, even up until yesterday already, there's still staffing issues and efficiencies that just went down the tubes because, you know, we had a working practice in March that was working quite well. And now with all the protocols and the PPEs and with staff, you know, some can't work. And, you know, understandably, we have to be understanding of, you know, if it's your turn this week that you can't come in, well, okay, so that department's going to be short. Now, how do we work with that? Because they're used to working with 15 staff members. And when we closed, we were down to 3. And then it was slowly working it back up.
I agree. I don't think there was ever a way to prepare for this. You know, a long time ago, I was part of writing an e-guide and training on how to prepare for a crisis, how to prepare your practice for a disaster. And, you know, even a lot of those protocols that we put into place that people could do to help prepare for a crisis, I don't think ever would have prepared them for this. So,
yeah.
No.
Well, and like I said, when things were changing so fast, yeah. I mean, we would ask our accountants for their opinions on how to work the employees, and we would ask our lawyer her opinion on what should we be doing, what is considered proper, and things were changing so fast that sometimes the answers was like, I don't know either. Like it's like,
well, they were probably trying to figure it out for their own business, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Robert A., tell us a little bit about what was happening in the shoe swap.
Well, the problem being the third panelist when the other two are already smarter than you is that they pretty much pick all the good stuff. But I would encapsulate that and say that our biggest challenge was just the unknown. You know, not knowing if the patients were going to come back, what their attitude was going to be, whether they're going to be buying, whether they're going to be really tight. And our other biggest challenge that I think we did a really good job with is maintaining the culture of our team. You know, reaching out to them, making sure that we're communicating with them a lot. So yeah, I would say maintaining culture and just the unknown were our biggest challenges.
Well, you know, similar to you guys, I mean, I don't own a practice, but I certainly own a company. And as an owner, it was challenging times. We have 43 staff, so pretty stressful, trying to make sure that we're looking after everybody, we're getting home, we're looking after our clients. And, and as you all referenced, it was changing day to day. And so it was a very busy time. It was certainly not a slow time. We didn't go home and take a break.
No, it was very busy. And I'm lucky that, I have 3 partners that are excellent. And then we have an outstanding office manager. So I really relied on those people to really help, especially with the culture thing. Because the other piece of the unknown puzzle is who's coming back staff-wise.
Right.
Right. And we were lucky everybody came back. But
we're going to talk about staff because it's an issue out there right now. So we'll chat a little bit about the staffing issues that are happening, but I'm going to go a little individually for the next few questions and spread out the wealth here a little bit. So Robert A. is going to get the first question. Talk a little bit about maybe some protocols you put in place in your practice for the practice, for staff. What are, you know, one, to keep them safe and to make sure, you know, you were doing what you could to create that environment of a safe environment. I know Robert M was saying about the PPE and cleaning supplies. Can you maybe talk about, you know, where you're sourcing those from, what's happening there?
Right. Well, for sourcing PPE, honestly, when we first shut down, we were shut down from mid-March until mid-May. At the beginning, as everybody knows, PPE was like scarce, and I ended up going to a local outdoors place like that sells chainsaws. All the dust masks that they had, and you could tell they've been sitting on the shelf for about 3 years. So we started with that, and then we ordered from Amazon, we ordered from Walmart, we ordered from local suppliers, we ordered from I Recommend, and you know, luckily we haven't had a problem yet as far as running short. So, and hand sanitizer was the other huge one. Obviously everybody was trying to get hand sanitizer and toilet paper, good grief. But anyway, have to keep everybody happy. So yeah, that was our PPE story. As far as protocols in the office, yeah, I think we did, you know, pretty similar to what most people were doing, you know, lock doors, temperatures, for staff when they come in, everybody has a questionnaire that they have to go through before they get into the office. The door is locked. In our main office, because it's a much higher volume office, we actually created a new position called the greeter. And the greeter opens the door, gives them a mask if they don't have a mask, hand sanitizer, measures temperature, all that kind of stuff, does the questionnaire before they can even come in to the office. As far as exam rooms, you know, everybody's wearing scrubs in the office. Obviously hand sanitizer until you think you're gonna bathe in it. Sanitization for the exam rooms, all the equipment, reduced patient numbers, you know, taking out most of the chairs in the staging areas and that sort of thing. What else? Yeah, you know, it's a pretty extensive list, but I don't want to bore anybody with the details because it's probably the same as most people are doing. But I do want to add something that I just learned yesterday, which I think was important for everybody to do, and that is to have your protocols written down. It's really important. And there was a case, and this is where Irene may have more information than I do, because it was in Manitoba. There was an ophthalmologist's office who had a positive case, like a patient was in the office, and later, is how I understand it anyway, they tested positive. And of course, all of us worry, what are we gonna do if we have a positive case? Do we have to shut down the office for 2 weeks? Do we have to contact all the people that were in the office at the same time? That's another thing that we do, by the way, is we record everybody that comes into the office and the time. So in case we do have to contact trace, we can do that. But essentially the case boiled down to the ophthalmologist phoned, or his office anyway, phoned, or her office, I don't even know, phoned the provincial health authority, and they went through the protocol and they decided that no, they do not have to close their office. And one of the reasons they gave is because the protocols were so good that they had in place. So that's why I would encourage all the optometrists, all the opticians that are on this webinar, have your protocols written down so you can present those to your health authority, and maybe it will prevent a shutdown for a couple of weeks.
Right. I know that I didn't have the two of you on this question, but do you have anything you wanted to add as far as, you know, sourcing PPE or different protocols?
Yeah, just the one thing that I would say is that when it comes to your plans and so forth, if your patients don't feel safe, it's all for naught. So I just feel it's really important to make sure that, you know, you're conveying, you know what you're doing in a proper manner that makes them feel safe. Makes a huge difference for how they're gonna, you know, feel about just being in the office. There's no question about it.
Yeah. Yes. I mean, everybody does want to feel safe. And I think it's actually a marketing strategy right now. You know, it should be part of your ongoing communications to your current patients and prospective patients of what you're doing to try to keep them safe.
I told our staff just yesterday at our staff meeting that if we're not getting complaints on both ends, we're probably not doing it right.
Yeah.
You know, some people are complaining that we're not doing enough. Other people are complaining that we're doing too much. So if we're not getting complaints on both sides, then we probably need to make some adjustments.
Yeah, that's good analogy. Irene, I'm going to come to you with the next one. I hear often one of the challenges is the constant sanitizing, is trying to keep up with that in between patients, in between, you know, somebody trying on glasses. So can you give us a little idea of what's happening in your practice?
What we're doing, basically what we sort of tried to implement is that whoever takes the patient cleans after them. So like if they happen to be, to sit on a chair of some sort, if I'm taking them, then, you know, I go right out with a cloth already and spray it as I point them in the direction and go, you know, go into my room and then I'll clean that chair. Or same thing with the dispensing, whoever the dispenser that took the patient out, what they're doing is they're pushing their chairs up so that you know that it's not clean, so that a doctor, if they come out, they don't sit them down in the spots, because, you know, with all the distancing, yeah, we're running out of spots to put patients down. And so, yeah, that's what we're doing. The other thing that the staff really, really like, when we were trying to figure out how to do the visual field machine, Melina, my partner, had found a spray bottle. It's a $20 spray bottle, but it's a fine mister, and you can spray it and you don't have to wipe it down anymore. It just has to, I think it has to just sort of sit there for 5 or 10 minutes. And so in the really, in some of the areas, like, you know, even when I can use 2 exam rooms, then it's great. I can just sort of spray the chair and I still wipe down the machine. But, you know, like some of the other spots that you didn't really like have to worry about as much before, it saves a little bit of time to just be able to spray and walk away. So we started off with one bottle. We're going up to 6 because, or no, 7, I think, just because otherwise everyone wanted the same bottle. And so it's just like, well, we have to get more.
Right.
And it saves them running around and trying to, especially because they all want the same bottle. It saves them all chasing the same bottle down. So to have them in sort of different spots, that's probably the biggest thing. And just being on top of everyone and reminding them to, that we have to keep that sort of protocol up. Yeah. And the doctors try to help out where they can, if they can.
I got a couple questions coming in, so I'm going to ask you, but I do want to say too, like, I went to the dentist last week for the first time since the lockdown, and it was a complete different experience. And they were, you know, everything was shields up, you know, in between reception to, they were garbed down. They had full, you know, full gowns on, full mask. She had 2 masks on and a shield. And I just, you know, I said to her, I don't know how you work like that all day. And she's like, you know, it's really tough. By noon, you just want to get it all off. So, you know, I realize we're still in close proximity to our patients, but I don't think we have it as bad as maybe dental does. But yeah. Okay, a couple questions.
Another thing I forgot to mention too, when we have an exam too, if we happen to walk a patient out, we close the door. So the other thing in the office, a closed door means that the room's not sanitized yet, so that they know. I've known other systems offices have like a buzzer, like a lighting system or something, but we aren't that fancy, so we just close the doors. And quick thing, I was doing it and a patient was sitting and dilating probably, and she watched me do this a couple times as she was sitting there. And so as I'm walking by her, she comes over to me. She's like, I just used the bathroom and I closed the door. I know the system. I'm like, thank you. I was like, I will get on that. So, you know, the patients appreciate it too. I've had numerous times patients like joking about us cleaning, but also very appreciative that we're doing it. So
great.
It's a hassle, but we do it.
So anybody can answer this. A couple questions from the audience is, Lisa Chase has asked, do you feel like suppliers or sales reps are doing enough in regards to sanitation on their end?
We haven't had any reps come in for quite some time. We had our Zeiss rep came in once, maybe twice, but I don't think we've seen any frame reps yet. So they've been keeping keeping their distance so far, actually. So yeah, I don't know if that's just because of our location, because we're not exactly on the beaten path, but yeah, we're not seeing many reps at all.
I don't see the reps, except for lens reps. So I can't comment directly on that, but what I can say is that they, for the most part, as far as I'm aware, all of our reps have been very respectful about, you know, before they come in asking, you know, A, is it, can I come in? B, you know, what do you need of me or want of me, you know, as I come in? But in terms of actually being here, I can't speak to that directly.
Yeah. Okay, great. And then Irene, somebody's asking about the spray bottle. They want to know where you get it.
I knew that someone was going to ask that. I will have to, I asked my partner just yesterday where she got it. And she said she actually found it on Amazon and she just Googled. I can't remember what she, I'll have to get it to you, Trudi, and then I can tell you exactly the company we got it from.
We can post it in the notes and in the, that'll show up in the recording so somebody can go back to it. Yeah. Okay, so we're going to go to Robert M. Tell us a little bit about how you're handling staff. And this is where we're going to get into staffing a little bit. Being back to work in a pandemic, you know, maybe their emotions, their fear, maybe just their, you know, security questions about their jobs. Can you maybe tell us a little bit about staffing? Yeah.
So just really quickly, so I did stay open for urgent care throughout, but I had to lay off most of my staff because it obviously just was not able to keep them. So, I had one staff member that I don't think she just could hack it. Like she just after we sort of fully opened, so to speak, excused herself a good, just a few weeks in, couldn't handle it. Honestly, became turned out to be a blessing in disguise, but that's another issue. But the staff has handled it really well. But let's just here and pat myself on the back for that. But I spent a lot of time before we, again, sort of fully opened, thinking about exactly that. Like you said, their anxieties, they're worried about their jobs, they're worried about the welfare. Like they're smart enough to know that, you know, the practice might be in jeopardy here with everything that's gone on and is going to happen. They're very anxious about their own safety. And understandably, you know, worried about, you know, it was interesting because, I basically brought everybody in. We had a meeting, an entire day, where we sat and, just chatted about kind of what's our plan going forward. And that made a huge difference. And I walked them through every single aspect from, you know, what's the plan in terms of how are we handling people coming through the door? What's our cleaning protocols? How are we getting supplies? And then we also talked about, you know, what's our business philosophy going forward? How, you know, again, they're not stupid. They knew that we're going to have fewer people. And how are we going to manage that? And so, you know, it made them really feel part of that discussion. It was frankly mostly me talking most of the time. I think that was huge because once they saw that I had really planned it out, that I'd really thought it out, that I really had an idea in mind exactly, you know, I mean, I went as far as literally walking through how a patient would come through the office and how the second patient, like literally broke it down that way. And so by the time they were done, they felt comfortable and confident in their safety and our patient safety and kind of how we were handling things. We'll probably talk about more of this later, but we talked about, okay, this is our grand design and plan for our maintaining our revenue stream. And so fortunately, I also happen to have a great staff, which helps, but you know, it's been very positive. You know, I have weekly meetings. So we reemphasize exactly what we're doing, why we're doing it. And obviously it's a little more focused on some of these things now, but yeah, fortunately it's been very, very good. But I think, like I said, it's a combination of having some good people, but just some very firm plans and some very thorough discussions and open discussions about how that was being handled.
Great, thank you. I'll tell you from a perspective of our company, because we own a job board as well in the industry, Jobs for ECPs, which has been crazy busy since practices have reopened. And I know that I hear the staffing issues for sure in Ontario, a little bit in Alberta. I don't know if it's the same in every province, but there is an issue with people finding qualified eye care staff right now. And I don't know if it's because some people are not willing to come back to work. I don't know if it's because of the, you know, protocols you put in place that you actually need more staff to run your business, and you've split up your schedule, and we're actually going to talk about schedules next. But I've got a lot of practices reaching out to us and saying, I'm desperate, I need some staff, and I'm getting a lot of unqualified people applying for the jobs because they're all in unemployment, but I'm not getting the qualified people. So it's definitely an issue out there. And the only suggestion I'll give you is you have to be showing up when somebody's looking. And so utilize all the channels, utilize an online job board like ours, utilize the, you know, optometrist association websites and the CAO websites and the optician websites, and, you know, just put that ad out everywhere so that you're in front of the people who you're trying to target. So we're going to move over to Robert A. and talk a little bit about, you know, the social distancing in your practice, but even more from a scheduling, you know, having to space out appointments to accommodate that social distancing, but still, you know, be able to bring in the revenue you need to almost make up for those 6 weeks that you were closed. How are you guys handling that?
Well, in our main office, it's the most challenging there because we normally have three doctors on staff at any one time. So we had this grand plan about 10 days, 2 weeks before we opened, that we were going to divide ourselves into teams. So each optometrist would have a team of whatever, six support staff to help them. We're going to open at 8 and stay open until 8 at night. And the teams are going to stay together and never intermix and all this kind of stuff. Well, the wheels fell off that pretty quickly. So although I still think that was a great idea, practically didn't work because of staff couldn't work that day or that afternoon, and they had to cross over. And as soon as they're crossing over, well, your bubble is basically burst. So we've reduced, we've gone down to two optometrists in our main office at a time, and spacing out, a little bit. Our office, we're lucky, our office is big enough physically that we can socially distance pretty well. We have six exam lanes, so one optometrist uses the exam lanes on one side of the office, the other optometrist uses the exam lanes on the other side. Limiting the number of appointments, we're seeing more patients per day now than we did before.
Is that because you're opening longer?
It's demand, honestly. There's a lot of pent-up demand. We're actually seeing more exams per day right now than we were before. But I think we're smarter about it. Even in the pre-test side of things, I think most optometrists would say they're probably spending less time in the exam rooms than they did before, relying a little bit more on pre-testing. We just upgraded our optos unit and bought one for our satellite office. And some of that is just because, you know, we don't want to spend quite as much time in our closed little exam room. That's a factor. Trying to keep the numbers down in the exam rooms as well. You know, no more family of five climbing over your equipment. Just the patient and a parent if we have to. So we started with that team idea. We kind of went back to sort of our normal schedule, but only two doctors at a time in our main office. The smaller offices are much easier, honestly. We keep the door closed and locked, to limit the numbers in the office, but really they're pretty much on their regular schedule.
Great. Yes, I've heard everything from, you know, practices opening earlier, staying later, trying to space out appointments more, opening weekends, really just trying, because there is a backlog, and trying to accommodate as many people as possible. I'm going to move over to Irene. And maybe tell us a little bit if there's anything that you've implemented in the last few months. I've heard a lot of it from touchless payment processing, texting when people are arriving, appointments for classes, anything like that that you guys have done?
We already had done the touchless payments. So the only thing we did is we have to actually get more terminals because, again, for less running around. One thing that, and we're getting still, is some people are doing pickups at the door. Like if we didn't, you know, if we didn't have to have them come in, especially like contact lenses or the dry eye drops or any of the things they need for dry eye treatments. And without having one at the door, they were having to go to the door, you know, and like give them their stuff, get their credit card, run back to the terminals and go back and forth. So we're working at getting one of those, assuming, you know, because of course we feel like this is going to be happening for a while. The dispensary did start making appointments to come in just so, and so everything in the office is by appointment only. So that, like I said, even just to come in to make an adjustment, they need to make an appointment to come in.
Do you have your door locked?
Yes.
Yeah. So your door is locked.
Okay. Yeah, the door is locked. We have like two doors. So we have an inner door. The inner door is locked and the outer door is unlocked so that we can at least tell if someone's trying to come in. So that's, yeah, so we did. And when it first came down though, we had locked both the doors. And so the only problem with that is that that was screwing us up for deliveries. At the beginning, companies weren't delivering. If your outer door was locked, they wouldn't deliver. They wouldn't even wait for you to come and answer the door. They would just come, they'd try the door, and then they'd be like, oh, you're not open, and move on. So we had to resort to opening, the locking the inner door so that they at least could come in. But now that's causing, now as we're getting busier and as people are feeling like they can, they have the freedom to move about, now we're finding there's like people aren't respecting the fact that if there's someone in the vestibule that you don't open the door and also come in and stand right behind them. So
yeah,
we're waiting, going back to locking that outer door again.
It's funny too, because I've heard a lot of opticians and the dispensers say, why didn't we start making appointments for glasses pickup a long time ago? And I've also heard, and you guys can tell me if you've experienced this, is that the capture rate has really improved because people aren't necessarily wanting to shop around.
Well, and they're in their safe little bubble too, right?
Yeah.
If people feel safe, it's just easier. I've gone through all this rigmarole. I'm here now. I'm just going to go ahead and do my shopping now. So yeah, I think that's absolutely true. The capture rate has gone up significantly. I mean, it seems like most offices are actually showing positive results year over year. I know for our first quarter, which starts July 1st, we're up 14% over last year. So the numbers are good despite the reduced number of encounters. So that's good. I actually have a question for Irene.
Yes.
Since it's due to snow there probably within a few days in Winnipeg, what are you going to do with what are you going to do when the weather changes with your locked door policy? Because that's something that we're struggling with right now. What are we going to do? Have people stand outside or wait in their car or what?
We try to tell them to wait in their car until they're called in. Yeah.
And you do that by a text, or how do you communicate?
We've been doing it by phone. Okay. In terms of that, and that has caused some issues because sometimes the phones are busy and people can't come in. So then, yes, a recent, like in the last few months, we were like some people would just come up to the door if they didn't have a phone and things like that. But at the beginning, it worked really well. We had them call to come up to the door. It would be a reason to have the vestibule still open so that at least they can come in out of the cold. We have a lot of seniors, so a lot of them don't have a way to call us. Yes. Like they literally have to come up to the door anyway. So that's their only thing is, yeah, we have the vestibule. Because we have, I think I maybe have seen two or three people extra standing outside. I feel some of that is just being impatient and they don't want to wait in their car anyways. And I feel that when it does get cold, and especially, like I said, at the beginning, it worked completely fine. People were willing to wait in their car until we called them back. So we would have to go back to that system if it was too cold. It was just that because it was, the risk wasn't as high and people could socially distance outside, it was very easy to say, okay, we're here. All right. Like, you know, take a quick look around the office. Sure. Come in, even if, you know, we can't, you know, there's someone in front of you, but, you know, originally it was like, you know, we'll call you back when you can come in. And it was just a lot of calling back and forth. So we were trying to, we'll have to adjust to that.
Yeah, we even thought about getting a cell phone, like a separate cell phone for the office, and get them to text us when they arrive, and we'll text them back when it's their turn or something like that. So yeah, we're still kicking around ideas.
So there's a suggestion that came in, and this is from Howard Dolman. And they said that they purchased the cell phone and added a $25 unlimited talk and text plan for the front desk. And it was kind of that parking lot check-in.
Yeah.
For those patients without a cell phone, they've also added a doorbell to their front.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think, you know, if this is going to stick around, texting is probably the easiest. Yes, understanding that some of your seniors won't text or don't have a phone, but majority of people do. So I'm going to move to Robert M. for the next question. Not that we want to think this way, but I think you have to, you know, at least prepare a bit. Is what are you doing to prepare maybe for the pandemic being around for a while until there's a vaccine or, you know, potential second wave and shutdown? Is there anything that you're doing right now?
Yeah, so I mean, in terms of being around for a while, you know, it's continuing our current course. I mean, we feel pretty pleased with the way things are rolling along. Our patients have been, you know, positive received. I mean, you know, I think the bulk of the population gets it, right? And we fortunately have had very, very few instances of those. Conspiracy theorists, etc., that don't believe it. But anyway, so yeah, I mean, we're keep the course. I've been doing a lot of phone or online telemedicine triage for my urgent care. In fact, the protocol right now is if we have a patient that calls in, you know, red eye, floaters, whatever, the staff puts it to me to sort of triage before they come to the door. Now, that doesn't mean I call every single one. I mean, I'm looking at someone saying, okay, book that person in, you know, three or what have you, but and it's funny because it sounds laborious, but it actually has been fantastic. It works really well in terms of screening and helps in terms of the people coming in out of the office. So continue on that course. You know, just continue with the same, you know, cutback schedule. So in other words, you know, we're seeing, you know, 2/3 of the comprehensive encounters we've seen. You know, we're limiting the follow-ups and that sort of thing and doing that effectively. But again, you know, it's worked well over the last couple of months. So why, you know, why change what we've been doing? It's worked well. In terms of possible shutdown, God forbid. As I said earlier, you know, we did choose to stay open for urgent care. So I feel like that we learned a ton through that. It was very helpful when we fully opened as well. So that was huge. You know, one of the great things about it, I mean, I wasn't making money, but I was certainly able to pay my bills. So I learned through that it's sustainable. You know, obviously I'd have to go back to, you know, laying off staff again, et cetera, but in terms of keeping my business alive, it's sustainable. You know, last time I did, and I would do it a little bit more thoroughly again, I reached out to all the local MDs, health clinics, even the hospitals to say, hey, you know, we're here for urgent care. And I couldn't believe the number of the positive response that was. I mean, you know, especially if you can imagine very on, like people are still panicked. I saw many people that literally I was the first person that they'd seen, the first person they'd stepped out of their own homes to see because they were that scared of what was going on. And so if they need to see somebody, they were pretty anxious about what was happening with their eyes, and they didn't have anywhere else to go. You know, they didn't want to go to the hospital. So they felt, you know, as much as they were, you know, reluctant to leave at all, they felt at least comfortable and confident here. So, you know, I would do the same thing again where, you know, we keep ourselves open for urgent care. You know, I'd make sure that we communicated. We did a decent job, but I've learned a lot through the first go around in terms of communicating with the patients. I mean, historically I've always hesitated to send mass emails. And I learned that last time that's exactly what patients want. They want to hear, you know, what's happening, what's going on with things like that. And so I think in times it's important. That's a thing, good thing to do. You know, I would, we've created an online store. We did that early on and, you know, we would push that to the next level if it keeps going on. Yeah. And just, you know, you know,
and you launched a new website during the pandemic.
Yeah, I was actually, all kidding aside, it was my next point was marketing. Once I kind of got over the first three stages of panic and realized that, you know, I wasn't losing my shirt, that, you know, we were going to be able to pay the bills, I did initiate a marketing plan that was long overdue. And and I thought it timely. I thought it timely because it was I'd been meaning to do a good social media campaign. And, you know, I'd like to say I was smart to think about it myself, but somebody else kind of mentioned to me, it's like, well, everybody's at home sitting in front, they're doing social media numbers are way up. Why not? And I'll tell you right now, it's been, and again, I'm not just saying this, it's been incredibly fruitful. So that, you know, I guess my point there is like, you know, don't be afraid in situations like that, maybe to spend some money. It may sound crazy at the time, but it's going to be beneficial. So that's huge. And then, you know, I spent a ton of time planning, you know, for, you know, what's happening now. And I would take advantage of that time again to do the same thing. So I'm going to be in need of a new office location soon. And so that would be the next, for me personally, that'd be the next thing I'd be doing is it's all right. Right.
Yeah. How's that gonna turn? And you know what, I think the practices that I saw weather this the best were the ones who utilized the time well, who, you know, kind of dug in and got things done that they normally don't have time for. Uh-huh. They prepped and prepared. They utilized all the government assistance. You know, they really, you know, went for it versus, you know, some practices who really felt paralyzed by the situation. And it goes to show you who really came out ahead in the long run. And you know, as a marketing agency, we saw the panic. You know, a lot of times people are like, oh, I gotta pause my marketing, when there couldn't have been a better time to capture people because they were sitting at home in front of computers. And and the other thing too is that because so many people pulled back on their marketing, it all of a sudden became cheap to market. You know, the spend was a quarter of the normal spend. And
Trudy, real quick too, the other thing that I did was that I have to say is I reached out, you know, I was planning, I talked about it. I'd like to say I was smart enough to think about my own, but I reached out to my partners. I reached out to, you know, I'm a big Nikon guy. I reached out to Nikon and they were amazing. I reached out to J&J. I had some great discussions with their people. I was able to, you know, talk to their people in marketing in both cases to say, okay, here's what we think's gonna, you know, their crystal ball, so to speak. And that was huge. It allowed me to kind of recognize what made sense for me to do at in my practice and how to move forward and to structure those plans to be, you know, come out of this probably stronger in the long run.
And, you know, on that note is, and we're going to go into our very last question here because we're going to start wrapping up. But on that note, I mean, we have a lot of supplier partners on this webinar today. And I think they want to help. They want to be there. You know, they've been super respectful of your time and your safety right now. But don't forget about them. Reach out to them. Their businesses are hurting too. And, you know, if we all kind of need to rally and support each other in the Canadian industry. And so I know they would all love to hear from you of how they could help you right now. As we wrap up, I'm gonna come to each one of you. And for those of you online, if you have a question, we're gonna leave just a couple minutes at the end. But what I want you guys to do right now is just, you know, share anything, a success tip. It can be a personal practice, business tip, you know, what you would want to leave as kind of a last bit of feedback to the people, you know, who are out there practicing, to the supplier partners, everyone out there. What is a, you know, something that you'd like to leave them with today? So I'm going to go to Robert A. to lead us off.
I'm just going to add to what Robert M. said, and putting my practice management trainer hat on, it's important from a business standpoint to keep some cash on hand. So if you're in a position that you can, you know, let your bank account grow a little bit to keep that cash on hand, that's important. And communicate with your lenders and suppliers, as you guys said, because they're all willing to help for the most part. So have that in place. Think of what you maybe could have done better during the last shutdown and prepare for the next one in case it does happen. Hopefully it doesn't. As far as lasting tips, I don't know. I think most people would say it went better than expected, the whole restart thing. But I think it went better than expected because most people put in a fair bit of mental energy trying to figure out, okay, what we need to do. And, you know, maybe that's the learning outcome here, is that maybe if we spent that much time thinking about our business when we were fully functional, maybe we'd be doing a better job, right? We had, most of us had like 2 months to do nothing but think, and maybe that's a net win.
Good point.
You know, there has to be some good things that come out of this, right? Irene, let's go to you.
So I would say for sure you want to try to keep updated on the protocols as they're changing, and just be able to roll with the changes. And I know for me personally, like a saving grace, whether you have partners, whether you are practicing on your own, was talking to other fellow colleagues. Like I said at the beginning, we were texting back and forth between a number of different offices. There were people that were in single offices that were reaching out to us, asking us what we were doing and needing someone to talk to. And I think talking it out, what you're thinking, what you're doing, the ideas, like, you know, even just talking like today, like the ideas that are coming up, those are things that you could, you know, we don't have to create everything on your own. Like there's so many things out there. There were so many webinars and meetings that I was listening to trying to get my head around all of this. And then in the end, like Robert McElpine was saying, was the, in the end, having that protocol written down and being able to present it to the staff and to patients. And, you know, I think they appreciated it. I know they mentioned it more than once that they really appreciated what we were trying to do. And they were really understanding when we did a complete 180 of what we just put out, like literally, like I put this out today and tomorrow, okay, so throw that out the window. We're going to do it this way now. Yeah, like I said, we just got to roll with it. With every case that outbreak that comes out, you know, constantly we're getting, does this change things? Does this change anything we're doing? And,
right.
You know, no, it doesn't, because, you know, as long as you're doing everything already, you have it all written down. That's sort of what I learned with the practice in Brandon that did get contacted. Like they have everything sort of set out and you haven't done, you're doing everything you can do. There isn't anything that changes if a case comes in. So you just got to keep going with it and hope for the best, right?
Right. Right. Thank you. And last but not least, Robert M.
What I would suggest more than anything is utilize your time for patient education. I mean, the one thing that we've done differently, seeing fewer people, you know, we kind of recognize, as been said before, that, you know, more people are probably going to want to just buy in-house and not go shopping. But we thought, let's take advantage of that and take it a step further. And let's really talk to people about, you know, the products, you know, what are the progressives really about, you know? I know personally, if I'm going to spend, you know, $500 more on something, I want to know what I'm buying. I'm going to do some research online. I'm going to talk to some people and try to figure it out. And, you know, I see people spend, you know, a lot more than a pair of glasses, and they really don't know what they're actually buying. So we just decided that, you know what, let's really take advantage of the fact that, you know, people aren't going to want to shop around as much. Let's really sit down and really explain to them much more thoroughly what it's all about. You know, why are they really buying this lens, you know, this high-end Nikon lens over, you know, some other product that's out there that they could get a lot less expensively? And we found that, you know, doing that effectively has been unbelievably rewarding. No question about it.
Great. You know, kind of the last tips I'll share and recommend, and again, if you guys have any questions, this would be the time to throw them up there. What we saw as a marketing agency is a lot of people, you know, and it was part of the panic, part of the shutdown is, how can I potentially still do some business? So we saw a lot of practices trying to implement telehealth. We saw a lot of practices implementing, you know, a contact lens e-store or looking at e-commerce options. And I think it's the right strategy is to start thinking about how can I take my practice more digitally? Not just, you know, in case of another shutdown, but it is going to be the way of the future. We have now taught everybody, even seniors, that they can absolutely do stuff online. And so how can we now even incorporate that more into our practices? How can we build the digital practice? And I think there's a lot of new technology and options out there. So we haven't had any questions come in. We've had just a lot of thank yous and, you know, cheers. So we're going to wrap up. We've got a couple minutes. I really appreciate all of you guys taking your time today, sharing great insights. This is going to be recorded, so we're going to push it out, but super appreciative of everything that you guys shared today. So thank you.
Thanks, Trudi.
Thanks, Trudi.
Thanks.
Well, thanks for having me.
Online. Bye.